I believe the organization that studies this in Minnesota indicated that the numbers, and I believe you announced this or mentioned this at the beginning of the program, the numbers of children born with fetal alcohol spectrum disorders in this country are between 40 and 50,000 a year. Now, just because the fetal alcohol affected child doesn't have the facial anomalies associated with fetal alcohol syndrome doesn't mean that they are not compromised with the central nervous system issues of behavioral and physical anomalies that accompany the prenatal exposure to alcohol. Now, in the mid-90s, the Institute of Medicine decided that fetal alcohol effect, the term fetal alcohol effect, was vague. So they incorporated different types of nomenclature, including alcohol-related birth defects. So sometimes you'll see these acronyms, ARBD, mm-hmm. Alcohol-related neurodevelopmental disorders, or prenatal exposure to alcohol. A lot of the researchers use that in their studies. So there are different acronyms that kind of fall under the heading of fetal alcohol effects.
Now, you said before that this is completely preventable.
Yes.
How is this completely preventable?
By not using alcohol. And one of the things that is being done and needs to be done in a more aggressive fashion is discussing these issues with young women who are of the age to become pregnant.
Before they become pregnant?
Yes.
And it should be a routine conversation, you think, between doctors and young women?
Doctors and young women, and also in health class.
Now, let me ask you,
high schools.
What about young men? Because do we know if alcohol affects sperm in any way?
There is research being done at this point in time, which indicates that the alcohol does affect sperm count and the makeup of the sperm. However, it's not really known how that affects the fetus.
How it affects the developing fetus?
But there are some theoretical ideas that indicate that, of course, somehow dysfunctional or deformed sperm is going to have some genetic impact on that fetus.
This is so typical, though, of the way research goes when it comes to fetal anomalies.
Yes.
You always they always dwell on the woman first, assuming because she carries the baby, and really the effect of the male contribution to the baby is really ignored until we suddenly discover, oh no, this and my educated guess is that it probably does affect sperm, and it might affect the formation of the fetus in
right.
very profound ways as well. This is an area of research that we don't know too much about.
And I believe the geneticists are going to be the people that are going to be looking at that more.
Right.
Because again, even how women metabolize alcohol depends on their genetic and cultural makeup, as well as, again, the synergistic effects of whatever other drugs they're taking. For example, Native Alaskans were introduced to alcohol relatively, late in our progression in the early 1900s.
Late in human history, you're talking about.
Yes.
Late in the progression of human history.
Yes.
And without exposure to that, bodies react to it very differently. And we're not talking about individual bodies. We're talking about the way genetic makeup has been passed down for many generations. So you're saying that some populations have had more experience with alcohol, genetically speaking,
yes.
than other populations.
Well, I have a very good friend from Ireland who always told me the dysfunctional family was one who didn't drink. She used to tell me that and say, wait. And, the beer has been a mainstay in Germany. The Europeans have had alcohol introduced into their society for a very long time.
The way to put this is different populations have had different experience with all kinds of diseases.
Yes.
And that's also why European populations had a lot of experience with smallpox and typhoid and measles, which is why they weren't nearly as effective as Native American populations that only had a very recent, beginning in the 17th century, experience with those diseases, and they were devastated. Entire populations died from that. Whereas in Europe, they had such long immunological experience that populations just reacted completely differently to that bacteria.
Beautifully put.
Yeah.
I like that. I like that analogy.
Yeah.
And that is exactly how it is.
I know that in the 1980s, I remember very well when fetal alcohol syndrome became, everyone was talking about it, and it was on the cover of every major news magazine, every women's magazine was talking about it, news shows were talking about it, and it happened right around the time when there came to be a lot of concern about cocaine consumption during pregnancy.
Yes.
And those two were kind of tied in together. And I'm wondering, now, a lot of people are very, there was a lot of talk about cocaine babies.
Yes.
A lot of worry about marijuana. Talk about that for a minute, because the one thing I want to emphasize on this show is that those drugs are not teratogens. You certainly shouldn't be using them while you're pregnant, but alcohol is so much more dangerous. Let's emphasize that for a few minutes.
And I believe what we need to look at is, again, the synergistic effect of those drugs with the alcohol, and looking at the byproducts, the metabolic byproducts that are introduced into the fetus by using cocaine and alcohol,
Now, okay. Or
marijuana and alcohol.
So talk about that a little bit more. So you're saying that when you combine the two, it's the worst of all?
Well, it absolutely is going to have more of an effect, because that's another drug that's being introduced into the body. So we don't know what kind of byproducts are being produced that are going to be affecting the fetus by using those two drugs. Now, with the cocaine babies, they found when they were born, of course, they had horrible withdrawals. The pediatricians commented on the high-pitched screaming that you would hear from these babies. And they would go through withdrawals just as any adult would go through cocaine withdrawals. The fetal alcohol child, or the prenatally exposed to alcohol infant, will also go through some of those same kinds of things in terms of the high-pitched screaming, the restlessness. There's going to be issues, again, with the central nervous system and how the baby responds to the mother. Maybe sucking is going to be...
We'll continue this discussion next week. Join us again next week when we continue our discussion with Dr. Peggy Proudfoot McGuire and talk about working with children who have FAS. For upcoming episodes, viewer feedback, and links to important information on health, log on to our website at the address that appears on your screen. Health Vision is a production of the WOUB Center for Public Media.